Hey y'all, my name is Prashant Kumar, or PK, and I'm an MCAT tutor at Shemmassian Academic Consulting. Today, we're going to be doing a passage walkthrough in the psych-soc section. You should be taking roughly 6.5 minutes on this passage, but today we're going to be going more in depth and taking our time so you can see exactly what's going on in my head as I take on this passage. Let's get it. All right, so I've gone ahead and put the passage on the left and all four questions we're going through on the right. So feel free to take a moment, pause the video, and go at it at your own pace. If not, let's get right into strategy. I like to maintain the same strategy going into any type of passage. The reason is I want to have something I can go back to regardless of whether the passage is easy or hard, sort of something to ground me. And for me, that strategy is read a paragraph, write a 3 to 5 word summary on it, make sure I understand, and then go on to the next paragraph. 3 to 5 word summary, so on and so on until we're done. The reason I like to do this is because it provides accountability. It makes sure I understand what's going on in a paragraph before going on to the next. Oftentimes, I'd find myself just reading emptily, going past paragraph by paragraph just for speed. And when I'm at the end, I'm realizing I don't really understand anything going on. By doing sort of a shorter passage walkthrough of paragraph by paragraph, I'm able to confirm that I understand what's going on before proceeding, saving me a lot of time in the long run. So with that, let's get right into the passage. Operant conditioning is a tool that behavioral psychologists often use to shape behavior. Researchers interested in studying operant conditioning decide to test a series of different reinforcement schedules on cats meowing and receiving catnip. Catnip is considered a desirable treat for the cats. So we have our paragraph. The question I always ask myself is, what's happening? And we want to do a 3 to 5 word summary, something super simple that we're not going to get overwhelmed with. And so for here, I'm thinking we write operant conditioning, catnip to meow. Okay? We really aren't trying to focus too much on the details, just like the big picture understanding of what's going on. Okay, with that, let's go on to the next paragraph. The researchers split the cats into 4 groups. Group 1 received catnip every 3 meows. Group 2 received catnip on average every 3 meows. For example, the catnip might be distributed after 2 meows or after 4 meows. Group 3 receives catnip every time a meow occurs after a time period of 30 seconds has passed. Finally, group 4 receives catnip every time a meow occurs after an average of 30 seconds has passed. For example, the catnip might be distributed when a meow occurs after 20 seconds or when a meow occurs after 40 seconds. Okay, same exact question. What's happening? And so for this one, I'm just going to write schedules of experiment, right? We should recognize some of these terms, right? Every meow, every on average, right? Different types of schedules associated with operant conditioning. But you'll see I'm not going to spend too much time on every single group. The reason for this is we don't know exactly what group they're going to ask questions about, if any of them, right? And so why waste time when we can come back if needed? But by just writing the schedules of experiment on the right side, we know what we're looking for and sort of have a roadmap to get back to this. All right, let's go on to the final paragraph. After a week without catnip, the researchers discovered that the cats began to meow less frequently. However, upon reintroduction of catnip, the cats once again began to meow at their normal rate. All right, so again, simple question, what's happening? And so here we see, I'm gonna write negative catnip, decrease meow, and then reintroduction, increase catnip, I'll just write CN, and then we say increase meow. Okay, so this is might be a little bit longer if you want, but I thought it was somewhat helpful to have this diagram written out in case a question asks for it. But see, a quick passage, we're not spending too much time on it, focus on the details, right? We're just focused on what's the big picture idea. And with that, we can go on to our questions. So question number 1. The reinforcement schedule for group 2 is known as A, variable ratio, B, B, fixed ratio, C, variable interval, D, fixed interval. Okay, so we want to go to sort of group two. And I'll go ahead and highlight what we're looking at right here. Group two receives catnip on average of every 3 meows. Okay, right away, we should note something very important, right? And we can look at the differentiation between group one and group two. Group one receives it after every 3 meows. Group two receives it on average. Right away, when we see that on average term, we should be thinking a variable, right? The difference between fixed and variable is that fixed will happen every single time after a certain level. Variable will happen on average a certain amount of times for a certain period. So that word on average really clues us in to getting fixed ratio and fixed interval out, because we don't know exactly how many times these cats will receive catnip. We know it'll occur on average. So now we have to differentiate between ratio and interval. And it's a reasonably easy way to think about this. Interval is more associated with time. Ratio is more associated with a specific event occurring, okay? So when we look at this, we see that it's on average of every 3 meows, which is not a unit of time. It's based on a unit of an event happening. So we can eliminate C, and we have A as our final answer. We're one for one. Great work. Question number two. Which of the cat reinforcement groups is most likely to have the highest meowing frequency? Is it A, group one? Is it B, group two? Is it C, group three? Or is it D, group four? And so this is going to be a standalone question, right? It's going to have an expectation that we understand some piece of information to make sure that we know which one is going to have the highest meowing frequency. And so what ratio schedule or what schedule produces the highest response rate? And the answer is a variable ratio schedule. And so with that, we take it a step back and we look at which group has a variable ratio schedule. Well, we actually just answered that in question one, and that's group two is going to have it. And so this is an important fact you should know in operant conditioning. A variable ratio schedule will have the highest sort of output or highest response rate. And so I think it'll be useful to just go through what type of schedule each of the other ones is on, just so we have it in our head. Group one receives catnip after every 3 meows. So that'll be fixed ratio. Group two receives catnip on average on every 3 meows. That'll be fixed or variable ratio. Then group three receives catnip every time a meow occurs after a time period of 30 seconds has passed. This is an example of a fixed interval, right? We're looking at how many seconds has passed, and it's every certain period. And so group three is a fixed interval. And group four receives catnip every time a meow occurs after an average of 30 seconds has passed. So this is an example of variable interval. Remember, we're looking for that word like on average because it's not every single time a period has occurred. So that gives us a good understanding of the different types of schedules we're going to come across. And we have answered question two. And we're on to question number three. In a new experiment, researchers discover that cats tend to walk around a body of water at a much greater distance than other animals. The cat's behavior is an example of A, avoidance, B, escape, C, habituation, and D, facilitation. Okay, this is a common type of question that you'll see on the MCAT. It's one that they give us a bunch of terms in our answer choices, and we need to know the definition of each of these terms. And so we'll go through them one by one. But what is the question asking, right? A cat is trying to stay away from the water than other animals. And so right away, we should see one answer choice that stands out. And that is avoidance. The reason for this is avoidance is an idea of negative reinforcement. Just like you're staying away to limit the amount of interaction with an unpleasant situation. So in this case, the cat is staying away from the water to limit its exposure to this unpleasant sort of stimulus. So A is seeming like our best answer, but let's make sure we understand what B, C, and D are. B, escape. This is an idea of, the common example is when a dog is in a shock, is getting shocked, right? It's going to escape that unpleasant stimulus. So it requires someone to be in a sense of an unpleasant stimulus and get out of it. And so in this case, for it to be an escape situation, the cat would have to be in the water initially and be trying to escape from that. So we can cross out B. C, habituation. So habituation is the idea that when you have a repeated stimulus, when you have a stimulus over and over and over again, your response is going to actually decrease. And so that is called the desensitization when you have a repetitive stimulus. And in this case, we don't really have a repetitive stimulus, nor do we have a decrease in sort of the response. So we can eliminate C. And then D, facilitation. This one doesn't really relate to the terminology of sort of operant conditioning. We've heard of social facilitation in the terms of how we react when we are given a task around other people. And so in this case, we are not focused on that. So we can eliminate D, and we have A as our final answer. So avoidance is our best bet, and we are 3 for 3. And we're on to our final question. Go ahead and erase this highlighting. And our final question. Which of the following is an example of positive punishment? Is it A, a student receives $5, B, a teacher gives a student detention for disrupting a class, C, a teacher gives a student a good grade on an exam, and D, a student gives $5 away? Okay, so we're focused in on this word, positive punishment, right? And so we like to think of this in terms of two words, right? The positive side and the punishment side. So what does positive mean? Well, in terms of operant conditioning, positive means adding something to a situation. So we're either gonna add something or more of something, okay? So I like to put a little arrow like up, so more. Punishment, what is that? Well, punishment is sort of a bad thing, something negative, something that's gonna not be like a prize. It's gonna be something that's, well, punishment, but something negative in that respect. So I'm going to put more negative. So more negative stuff. And so that's how we want to think of these things, right? We want to think of it in the simple terms, something we can think of. So it's the addition of something negative. And so right away we see a student receiving $5 is not receiving more negative, right? We also don't know what the $5 are associated with. Is it associated with a punishment, or is it just like the student's receiving $5 for no reason? And for that reason, I'm going to eliminate A and then also D, right? He's giving away $5, but we don't really know why he's giving away $5. It's not really associated with anything. So A and D are gone. Now B seems like our best bet right now, right? You're adding detention for disrupting a class. So you're giving more bad for something. So B is looking pretty good right now, but let's just look at C. A teacher gives a student a good grade on an exam. So in this case, we're giving something, so there's that positive part, but we're getting a good grade. And that good grade is going to be an example of reinforcement. So that's an example of more positive or more good. And so we can cross that out and say B is our best bet. And so there we are. We're 4 for 4. Great work, y'all. We crushed another psych-soc passage walkthrough and mastered topics around operant conditioning, different types of schedules, and even avoidance and escape learning. So good job to you guys. If you liked the video, give us a like down below and subscribe to our channel. Comment exactly what walkthroughs you're looking forward to next. If you enjoyed the video, please check out our other ones, especially Vikram's 528 walkthrough series, in which he gives you strategies that'll help you achieve your dream score. And finally, sign up in the link in our bio for MCAT question of the day so you don't miss out on a single bit of studying before test day. Happy studying, and let's get it.